welcome everybody. A big thank you for being here tonight. I know, first of all, it's cold and dreary out there, but secondly, there's always so much going on and other things that you could be doing right this moment. So we really appreciate you being here. And then secondly, a favor, we'd really like an upfront and personal conversation, and we are really wanting to hear from you. So if any of you would feel comfortable coming a little bit closer, that would be lovely. It would really lend to a conversation. I know with the kids, they're always doing exactly what you're doing. Oh, thank you so much. Appreciate that. So I'm Kathy McLeod, for those of you who may not have met me, superintendent of schools, and it's my honor to be here tonight. This night has been a long time coming. We've been talking about the idea of a turf field for as long as I've been here, and then for many years prior to that. And this year, I think we finally have it right, because we have a really well-informed and cross-section of a committee that's been working very, very hard under the direction of Dee King, our new athletic director. And tonight, we're really going to tell you what has happened so far, introduce you to the committee, let you know the work that's been going on. And we had a plan to have some breakout sessions, but kind of looking at the crowd and feeling like we really want this to be more of an information gathering night, we think that we'll stay right here, do the presentation, and then do some Q&A on some different topics that I'm going to outline. So first, we have really wanting to gather feedback from you, which I've already said. We plan to introduce Dee and basically get some background and history. And then representatives from Gail are here tonight, Kathy Herbel and Sean Boyd, who've done a lot of work with the committee to date on design. And they'll share with you some of their thoughts and some input that they've had to date. There's been extensive thought put into a variety of solutions and options, and they'll share that with you. Then we really want to talk about some comparables. So what's going on in other district facilities? What is the current usage of our fields? What are some opportunities that we feel might be there for us in terms of revenue? Community use and potential, so some potential partners that might be out there. And then finally, the discussion on natural turf versus synthetic, which clearly we know is something that needs to be looked at very carefully. We kind of wanted to have a little sense of who's here tonight before we begin. So if you don't mind, a show of hands. Parents of elementary age students. Parents of middle school. Thank you. High school. And you could put up your hand.
Many, two hands.
Three. I don't think I see any students. Students. Hello. coaches. So you are coaches and parents, which is excellent, right? Yeah. Are you coaches for us? Yes. All right. And then other representatives that I haven't mentioned.
Grandparents.
Very important category. Probably the most important category, I would say, right? Well, thank you. We really are looking forward to sharing with you what we have learned to date, sharing with you the work and the thought that's gone into where we've arrived, and then to reinforce that we are just at the beginning. We have not in any way made a decision. We're nowhere near a recommendation. We really are at the point where we're seeking public input. And at that, I will turn it over to Dee King.
Thank you, Kathy. Kathy gave a nice introduction to the layout of how our evening is going to go, and I would like to echo her thanks in your coming out to attend our public forum tonight. I know everyone's pulled in lots of different directions, and it really means a lot to a committee who's put a lot of work into being here tonight, but especially to me, and knowing that we have members of our community who are interested, invested, curious, want to learn, or provide thought and feedback. So again, thank you for being here tonight. What I wanted to share with you a little bit tonight is for me, the past 6 months and really quickly how that's gone and then what's bringing us to this point of being here tonight. So in the last 6 months that I've been here, it has been an amazing experience of really being learning about a community from a different perspective. I've been a part of the Hopkinton school community for 8 years, but to be able to see it from the athletic lens, really seeing how invested and committed our student athletes are, how passionate and knowledgeable our coaches are, the parents who are, I have parents probably every day in some capacity asking how they can help, how they can support, what they can do. And on top of that, community members who don't have sons or daughters in the school, but who just want to help. It's been really amazing for me to see the outpouring of support from the community for our school system and specifically our athletic programs. So that's been one of really a highlight if I was to look back on the past 6 months of how things have gone. But I think I would have been dreaming a little bit if I didn't anticipate some challenges entering a new role. And there have been challenges, and I think some of them public, which some of you have seen, and some that have been sort of behind the scenes logistical. And so one of the concerns or things that has really sort of been brought to light for me in this role in the past 6 months has been the lack of turf fields that we have here at the high school. And really quickly, I'd like to just highlight for you how those were brought to light and how we came to be here today. Some of the things in the fall that came up, the need to outsource some of our practices to prepare for games. Some of our teams are feeling inadequately prepared for their games because we have natural turf fields, which is wonderful, and I am a huge fan of natural turf fields, so I think it's important to note that. But when you're playing a game on turf, as many of you know, it's a completely different surface and the preparation isn't the same. So that's one thing that really came to light. Additionally, we had some opposing schools for non-league games in field hockey, for example, say, thanks for the invitation to play you, but we really are looking for games on turf because that is where field hockey is predominantly played and we want to be adequately prepared for our season and for the postseason. So for me, that was eye-opening to say, teams aren't coming to play us because we don't have turf. And that just felt really unfair to our kids. Additionally, weather concerns for us, when it's pouring rain and the fields might get muddy because that's what happens, we're having to get kids into the gym and squeeze into practice times, whereas other towns are able to play and practice even if it's pouring rain because turf does allow for that at different times. So just some certain logistical constraints from scheduling and things like that that came up. And what hasn't necessarily come up yet, but that what is to come is, as you know, we live in New England and we're blessed with winter weather, which hasn't been too bad so far, but oftentimes in mid-March there can still be snow on the ground. And if there's not snow on the ground, sometimes it's melting, and that really impacts ability to play on fields because if those fields are saturated and we're putting kids on them, one, it's not necessarily good for them in terms of preparation, but two, it can rip up the field. So other towns are getting tons of time to prepare in their preseasons, and we're having to outsource that or relocate games so our kids aren't getting to play on their home field soon. So this is certainly a concern that exists and that has, but is also, for me, anticipated, even though I haven't been through it yet. So given all those factors, and different conversations that have existed in the summer and certainly years before I got here, it really felt important for us who are here and invested in the school to think about this and talk about it and really make sure that we're exploring all options for our students and our community. And so what was done starting at the beginning of the year is that we really worked hard to put this into motion and say, if we're gonna look into this, we wanna look into it the right way. And I will certainly say that I am not an expert in many of the areas that are important to consider in this process, but we have an incredible community with people who are so willing to help and support. And we were amazed at the interest in people wanting to be involved on this committee. And we feel really lucky to have established a committee, as Kathy mentioned, with just a cross-section of members who have who are experts in a variety of realms. And you'll hear about that in a little bit. But so we established this committee, and I'll introduce them just in a moment, just so that you know who's part of it. And we've met a lot for a long time, sometimes late nights, and that is so appreciated. So there's been a lot of thought put into where we are today, but again, no decisions have been made. So in that committee, we've been able to hear presentations from Gail, who's here tonight, and another engineering firm, Warner Larson, who conducted feasibility studies on locations at our high school field locations, just to talk about the viability of turf and how it would look at different locations. And there's been a lot of discussion on all the variables, many of which I'm sure you're coming in here with questions about tonight, that will be addressed. And we came tonight with a phased project outline that has been something that we've thought of, that Gail will beautifully outline for you, but we want to hear your feedback. No decisions have been made on anything, and we're really hoping to have tonight as a place to gather thoughts, questions from the community, and be able to really address those so that, as I said, we're making sure that as a school system and community, that if we're looking to undertake a project this large, that we're really doing it in the right way so that everyone feels part of it and everyone is on board with it. So that just sort of lays out for you what's been done so far. So I wanted to take a moment, as I've mentioned to the committee, and really acknowledge them for the hard work that they've put into this, and do a quick introduction for those who are here right now, just so that you get an idea of who's participated. So if I could just really quickly go down the line and do that. Evan Bishop, our principal, is here tonight, and he's been an active part of that committee, and I'm just going to go down the line of who's here. So Kelly DiPaolo is a member of the community at large. She's had significant experience in education, athletics, and has brought a lot to the table. Jean Birchman, who is on our school committee. We have Amy Mick, who is athletic facilities administrator and who has a wealth of knowledge through her work with Hopkinton Youth Soccer and Fruit Street. Kathy McLeod, superintendent of schools, as you know. We have Jim Vallis, who is here for his finance background. John Schwartz, who is our public relations and marketing specialist. Ed LaFleur, who works in construction and has been part of many turf field projects and has brought a ton to the table that I think for all of us, we have learned a little bit about the background that goes on that, again, was new for all of us. Brian Herr is here as a member of the Board of Selectmen and has been a fantastic liaison for us and has been able to weigh in on some historical perspective in the town as well as a pulse of where things are at right now. And I don't know if I missed anyone else who's here tonight, but I think that's it for tonight. Okay, and there's some other members who have been here as liaisons and other members of the committee who have really been active participants who are unable to make it tonight, but you're able to see that up on the screen. So that's a little bit of background on what's happened so far, but I think that if I was to really try to wrap things up before I hand the mic over to Kathy and Sean, who are here from Gail Associates, I think that at this point, not only can I talk to you a little bit about the needs of our athletic department, but this is something from a community standpoint that has amazing option as to have a turf field complex is something that is used as a community gathering place. It's something that brings togetherness in the community, and we've been able to witness that in surrounding towns. And it's something that, again, we think is worth exploring for our kids, for our community. And so we thank you for being here tonight to show interest in that. And I am now going to introduce Kathy Hervel and Sean Boyd, who are here from Gail Associates, who will be able to speak to you much more intelligently about the feasibility study and the phase project. But we are grateful for them being here, and I hope that you enjoy learning a little bit tonight about the what's been done so far. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Dee, and thank you all for being here. Again, my name is Kathy Hervel. I'm with Gail Associates. With me is Sean Boyd. He's the project engineer on the project. We were brought on board back in April of this year. Gail Associates conducted actually two feasibility studies for the school, the public schools. The first was with focus on what we call field 4 and 5, and I'll touch base on that a little bit just to narrow people in. We also looked at the existing track and field, which is the football field, as well as field 13. So just to give you a sense, our feasibility studies, we look at a realm of items, environmental impacts, drainage structures, costs, obviously, use, programming for the school and meeting their needs. So, and working with the committee, looked at items such as parking and things along those lines as well. So I'm going to hand this to you, Sean, for a minute, but because I'm better without the mic. I talk with my hands, but just to zero people in, on the far side, you'll see our kind of an overall plan that we have of the, that the, actually, when you go on the Hopkinton High School athletic website, this pops up for you to use to find the field where your kid's playing ball that day and helps narrow in. Our focus, like we said, is just to get a sense, down at the lower end of the page, you'll see that's the high school and the middle school are the two building structures. The one on the right, a little bit larger, looks like the middle school. You'll see just up above that, you see field three, which represents your track and your field. And just below that is field four and five. Then we also, like I said, looked at field 13, which is way around the loop road, kind of far up on the, in the far left-hand corner. Just to give people a sense of what field we focused on and which we were asked to study. And this is just an aerial, again, just to give you an aerial view of the fields, again, just a little bit of view. Just to let you know, based on meetings with the committee, the feasibility studies and such, that based on parking and also the remote location of field 13, it's basically has been eliminated from consideration at this point. I'd just like to mention that. So one of the things, like I said, we get into is we look at constraints, obviously. What are the issues affiliated with this, especially environmental concerns? Do we have environmental constraints associated, say, with field four and five, which is, you can see the softball, baseball, and then there's a multi-purpose field that sits in between there. That's what we refer to as four and five. And then obviously at the track and the football field, just to the lower end of the page. But one of the things, some of the things we look at which could impact time and schedule is environmental impacts. We've looked at things like, are there any endangered species that could impact permits and that could prevent these projects from moving ahead. On field 4 and 5 in the northwesterly corner, we do have some wetlands up above. You can see kind of some red up on the top there. Basically, we'll require, that tells us that we most likely need a permit from the Conservation Commission, again, to impact the timing of the project. Right now, what we'd be proposing to do is work at that existing field would only be in the buffer zone, but we still would require the permit through the Conservation. Right now, as far as we're aware, field three does not have any real environmental
Yeah, well, let me. One of the things we touched on as well is when looking at a synthetic turf project, we always strive to make sure that student athletes in the community get the best bang for their buck. And looking at the existing track and field facility, one of the first things we noticed is that you have a very narrow track, meaning the width inside the track of the playing field is not ideal for soccer. NFHS, the National Federation of High School Sports, recommends that soccer be played at 195-foot width. Given the runways and the shape of the track, 195-foot field will not fit inside that track. The other sport that it's not an advantage for is women's lacrosse. That as well wants to play at a wider dimension. And given the existing constraints within the track, that field does not play at the ideal width as well. The other things we focused on is the age of the track. The pavement underneath was constructed in 1998 with the school project. And in the industry standard for asphalt, the black, same as the parking lot you drive on, is roughly 20 to 25 years. At that 20 to 25 year mark, the pavement is going to experience structural issues and it's going to fall off its curve, and it's going to need time to be replaced. So in taking on a synthetic turf project where we're already thinking about expanding the track, the asphalt underneath the track surfacing is getting to the end of its useful life, it provides an opportunity to tackle both projects at once, which is one of the things we'll talk about when we get to the proposed condition. Again, this slide just reiterates some of the ideal playing field dimensions. What is recommended, what can be achieved given the existing track footprint. As I pointed out, you'll notice that soccer and women's lacrosse don't have the ability to play at that ideal dimension. The other thing we focused on is the existing conditions. the shape of the existing fields, what the student athletes are experiencing in the first few weeks of their spring. Sports tends to be the worst from a saturated playing condition, and we've certainly gotten feedback about fields 4 and 5 that the playing condition is very wet. This is where a synthetic turf field option can help improve that condition, get student athletes onto the field sooner in their sports season, and improve the condition of the field. I know part of the struggles with Dee is scheduling events, and once you, and Dee kind of mentioned on this before, but once you play on a saturated root zone, even once, you've hurt that field, and the performance of that field, especially for field hockey, where you have the ball rolling across the surface constantly, you see a real issue with being able to perform that sport at a high level. So over-compaction, playing on a saturated root zone, does not set the condition for a well-maintained natural grass field, which is what ideally what everyone strives to play on. It's the synthetic turf companies, they strive to mimic natural grass. That's the benchmark, that's the standard. But with all of the scheduling and issues we see in a lot of communities, it's a struggle to maintain that level of turf, which is why synthetic turf is usually introduced as an option for student athletes and for the communities.
Basically, we've conducted our evaluation. Like I said, we looked at existing conditions and such, and working with the committee, like, as they said, they've met numerous times. They've gotten input from various sources, as well as the feasibility studies that we conducted, and have come up with preliminary recommendation. The first phase that's proposed is to do a synthetic turf field at field 4 and 5. That would be a more straightforward installation. And we also, because of the size involved, might pose more opportunity for community use. Our second phase that they would be proposing, again, tying with the potential redoing of the track, would be doing the football field, field 3. And then the last phase, looking at an amenities building somewhere to service the complex later on.
Yeah, so the first phase, and as Kathy mentioned, is just really trying to capture and affect as many student athletes as possible with baseball, softball, and then the multi-use rectangular sports in the outfield. You can see the entire area is proposed to be synthetic turf. They introduced portable mounds, which allow you to, in the multi-purpose rectangular use, remove that mound and use that turf field in many different directions. The next slide will show an organization of youth soccer fields that the community can organize within that footprint to capture as many teams as possible. This is a large complex. It's an approved drainage system. One of the things we noted and saw in the existing conditions was, and as I mentioned, the poor drainage in this facility. It's in proximity to the wetlands. Introducing synthetic turf, there's a number of different design aspects that we will look at if and when we get into a design phase for this, but there's a base stone underneath it that can be used to capture runoff. Instead of a natural grass field, it's a sheet flowing across, water's traveling across that surface. The synthetic turf surface allows water to infiltrate right into the surface and store within stone underneath. This allows for a much faster drying condition where you're able to play on fields when it's raining and soon after. Especially in the spring, this is a huge improvement for this area.
Under this scenario, obviously, as Sean talked, we have an improved drainage system. We'd also be addressing some ADA compliance issues coming in off of the loop road. Could use some improvements. We're proposing lighting at this time, athletic lighting, to get you the optimum usage of the field, not maybe perhaps for the high school, but also for the community. We've included some portable bleachers. We put in some pricing just to cover a storage building just for equipment and such in that area. And our approximate cost for this field is approximately $3.4 million. Just wanted to note too, as I know we are showing baseball and softball on this scenario, the final field configuration would be evaluated, you know, as the project proceeds, and it could be a combination of many other types of fields, like I said, running perpendicular or a couple of smaller, more practice fields, things that, whatever's going to give the school, as Sean said, more benefit of the buck and, you know, more community use.
Thank you.
And again, like you said, with the community, this is just an example of, you know, perhaps you've got a youth soccer tournament, and you know how this area could be divided up into some, you know, five smaller fields for a tournament, something along those lines.
The track and field setting in phase two setting it sets the condition that as that track gets to the end of its useful life. And we'll show a couple pictures of past projects that we've worked on where a similar situation was completed. But we're expanding that track width. This allows for that ideal soccer and women's lacrosse field to fit within that oval. However, it does require a little bit more earthwork and a little bit more construction from a retaining wall standpoint between the proposed field four and five and the new track. But this option allows you to get all of the sports at their ideal widths. It shows a visitor's bleacher system. It includes athletic lighting. As I mentioned, it includes earthwork and retaining walls. It does respect the existing grandstand as a cost-effective measure. The grandstand was in good shape, and it respects that existing structure. The total cost for this project at a pre-design estimate we're showing is about $3.1 million. This is consistent with projects of this similar scope and size that we had completed earlier this year.
And again, this field would be lit to give optimum usage. Obviously, there's existing lights. We make modifications as necessary, mostly for the expansion towards field four.
And then phase three would be an amenities building. One of the things with introducing a bleacher system in any project, the permanent bleacher system, requires fixtures, plumbing fixtures within 500 feet of that structure. So in past communities, sometimes it's phased in the future, sometimes it's done with the project. It all depends on working with the local building inspector on that permit and that certificate of occupancy. Some examples that we've incorporated into the past is a building can be used as an entranceway statement. You can use for concessions and storage. One of the things we see a lot with these facilities is a number of hurdles, is a number of high jump pads, pole vault pads that need a place to store. So using the existing buildings that are out there, incorporating into any potential new building, it's got a number of uses that can be used. Some past examples, you can see the bottom right image is Triton. They decided to use it as their entranceway statement where you're walking through. So part of the discussions in future phases is working with the committee, coming up with the player and spectator experience when they arrive at the site and how they will walk through the site and watch a game. Those are the types of aspects that we need to go through to situate a building on site. The typical schedule, again, there isn't a set schedule for this project, but one of the things that we've worked with in the past and we've published blogs on our website are a lot of the questions we get is, well, how long does this process take? So usually September, October, once the school year starts, we'll get calls about projects for next summer. And that's the majority of when these projects are completed are during the summertime after graduation. And we strive to get it before football, not always the case depending on the scope. But in September, October is when we initiate the project, and that starts your background investigation, actual survey, going on site, locating all the various site features, getting an understanding of the grades and how the topsoil is graded on site. And then we go into permitting and design documents, construction documents through the winter, typically permit after the new year, and then bid the project to prospective contractors in early spring, late winter, early spring, which sets the condition for a summer construction. That's a very standard schedule. Like I said, depending on scope, construction can take 12 to 16 weeks if you add a building into all of it, do it all at once, and it extends a little bit longer. But usually sometime from, like I said, graduation to the beginning to middle of fall is when these projects get completed.
You're just going to hit on quickly some, you know, maintenance costs, life cycle costs. People ask, you know, are the turf fields more expensive? Do they cost more to maintain and such? So
So one of the things that we've done in the course of our business is we've worked with existing facilities directors, most recently the one in Triton. We've asked them to capture all of the existing costs that they use or they perform on their field for maintenance, their game field. And one of the feedbacks we get is usually somewhere between $25,000 and $30,000 depending on the facility, but that includes mowings, waterings, aeration, line markings is one of the biggest ones that we see. Fertilizer, winterization of the irrigation system, those types of costs. And as I mentioned, so we're showing a $25,000 per year for this model. For infield synthetic turf, it's variable. It depends on whether it's permanent lines or painted lines. If you go with painted lines, you're not painting it as much as a natural grass field, but there are still some costs. As well as the other advantage of synthetic turf is the ability to snow removal. There's a cost associated with that as well. So what we've experienced and the feedback we've gotten from past projects and past and owners is that it's about $25,000 per year for natural grass, about $9,000 per year for synthetic turf. When we take these annual maintenance costs, use the estimated construction costs, and show a lifespan of, I think we had done 28 years, was it? The 12 years. So if you go to the next slide, Kathy, I'll show it better. So what we've done is we brought all of those costs back to today's dollar and got a net present value of what a natural grass field project would cost. And you can see the number we came up with given the annual maintenance costs, as well as at every 4 years or so, a more robust maintenance effort. Maybe you're sodding between the hash marks where football is about $841,000. When you look at synthetic turf, there's a more upfront cost, the cost to construct, less cost annually, and you'll see the net present value bringing back to today's cost is more. Synthetic turf is actually it costs more in the long run from a dollar to dollar standpoint. The one thing you'll notice from a use standpoint, because you're able to use the field more often, it's much less. 1,900 compared to, I think the previous slide is 3,300. You're able to cycle kids and student athletes on and off those fields more. Industry standards we're seeing for a well-maintained natural grass field, you're able to use about 250 uses per year, and that's assuming that you're resting that field, which is very rarely done. Compared to synthetic turf, we're seeing anywhere from 600 to 700 uses per year. The issue really becomes how quickly can you schedule and get teams on and off that field to get the next use. So there's a big difference in the number of uses the field would experience per year.
Keep in mind too, the turf field, the day it's finished, you can play on it right away. Natural turf field or grass field, well, you have to wait for that field to get established. And also when you do more major maintenance on the natural grass fields, there is, as Sean said, a rest time, a downtime that field is taken out of commission.
So we wanted to show a couple of past projects, some comparable to what we've shown on the proposed solutions, but first being Norwell. And the reason why we're showing this one is this is a large multi-purpose rectangular field. This one does not have baseball, however, it does have a softball bump out in the bottom right-hand corner. This is a similar project to what field 4 or 5 would look like if you're adding baseball to the top left-hand corner. But this gets used. The main reason that they installed this was for youth soccer. They play soccer in the opposite direction. You can see the white striping in the compared to the yellow striping, which is the main soccer from end to end. The white striping across the field. The next project we wanted to show was Triton. The overall image for Triton. This is very similar in the sense that they expanded their track in order to gain that ideal playing field dimension. And they installed on average a 6-foot retaining wall on the right hand side. It's the marsh side of the field. This is very similar to what we're showing for the track and field and that expansion and how that retaining wall would look in the bottom right hand corner. It incorporated new athletic lighting as well as a new, as I mentioned before, a new amenities building. But very similar type of project to what we're showing in the proposed images tonight. Next steps.
Okay, so thank you so much to Kathy and Sean for presenting to us their findings and recommendations. And so tonight, as Kathy initially mentioned, we had talked about maybe having some breakout sessions, but given the size of the group, we thought it would be okay to stay here. And so we wanted to just get general thoughts from the audience, questions, and many of which we probably won't have the answer to tonight, and we hope that's okay with you. That is the purpose of having this forum early, is so that we can gather thoughts and feedback and be able to really thoroughly and adequately answer them and address them in our committee work, so that we, as a community, you feel like your answers, your questions are getting answered, and that all factors are taken into consideration. So at this point, we will be recording down what the questions are, and then once we've wrapped up, I can talk a little bit about the next steps. So thank you all for being here. Thank you, Kathy and John.